Okay, chapter 7 is on periodic trends. So when we look at the periodic table, determining what we can compare between atoms based on their location. So remember, elements in the same group generally have similar chemical properties. So that means that they are in the same column on the periodic table. And a few trends that we'll run through are sizes of atoms and ions, ionization energy, and electron affinity. These are three things we want to be able to compare based on the location of an atom. So first, we have to understand this concept of effective nuclear charge. It's really exactly what it sounds like. How effective is the nuclear charge, which is the protons in the nucleus? The neutrons are also there, but they don't have a charge, so they're not pulling on the electrons at all. So what we would say is it's the force with which the nucleus pulls on the outer electrons. So we're trying to see how strongly is the nucleus pulling on the outermost valence electrons. So here's kind of a picture. If you have lithium, you have three protons in the nucleus. So that means it's kind of like a magnet with a size of three or a strength of three. And then lithium's electron configuration tells us that it's 1s2, 2s1. So we have two electrons at the n equals one level, one electron at the n equals two. So what we know is that the electrons are attracted to the protons, but they're also repelled by one another. And there's also this concept of shielding. So if we're looking at the outermost electron, we see that he's attracted to the protons, but that there's these two inner core electrons that are shielding or getting in the way between him and the protons. Okay, and then if we see beryllium, I've kind of drawn it, there's a magnet of four. So do you get that its magnet is a little bit stronger than lithium? But it's a really similar structure because it's 1s2, so there's your two electrons at n equals one, and then you have two outer electrons at 2s2. And so the way we can kind of compare these two in effective nuclear charge is generally looking at this down here. You take the atomic number, which is sometimes called Z. It's not important that you know that. But the atomic number, which is just the positive charge due to the protons. So 3 versus 4. We're gonna compare that. And then we're also gonna compare the screening, which really just means how many core electrons are between the nucleus and the outermost electrons. And then you subtract. So you take the atomic number and you subtract out the screening electrons. So if we look at lithium, you've got a 3 for its atomic number, minus 2 core electrons. So you have an effective nuclear charge of 1. If we move over one spot on the periodic table to beryllium, you have a magnet of 4, that's your atomic number, minus, you still only have 2 that are screening, right? Only 2 core electrons. You do have an extra valence, but that extra valence isn't getting in between the nucleus and the outermost electron. So it's 4 as the atomic minus 2 as the core, and you have an effective nuclear charge of 2. So if you'll notice, beryllium has a greater nuclear charge than lithium. We're going to see that that's actually a trend. On the periodic table, moving left to right, on the periodic table, you are increasing protons every step of the way. So left to right, you're increasing protons. You're also increasing electrons, but you're increasing electrons on the same energy level, so you're not changing the core. So therefore, as you go left to right, you're increasing how effective your nuclear charge is, okay? And then if we think about columns moving up or down the periodic table, you increase the nuclear charge as you go up, because think about as you go down the periodic table, you are adding electrons to a whole new level. And that means that you're also increasing the shielding factor. And your electrons are being added further and further and further from the nucleus. So you have higher effective nuclear charge up top. So this affects several of the trends we'll talk about. Most closely related is the size of atoms. And when we talk about the size of atoms, we talk about the atomic radius. What the radius is if you had two hydrogen atoms here with one proton, and they each had one electron, and they're sharing these electrons. This is a bond between the two hydrogens. This distance between the nucleus and the shared electrons is called the bonding atomic radius. Really, we can boil it down to the radius is the distance from the nucleus, so the middle of the atom, to its outermost electron. So really it makes sense. It's just the radius of the atom. What we can see is that the atomic radius tends to decrease from left to right across a row. So what did we just say about the effective nuclear charge? As you move left to right on the periodic table, your effective nuclear charge gets bigger. What that means is your protons are more effective at pulling the electrons in. So does it make sense that as the nuclear charge is getting bigger, the atom is going to shrink and get smaller because it's pulling the electrons in? So what we see is over here in the right side of the periodic table, these are your smallest atoms because they have really high protons for their number of electrons or for their energy level, so they pull them in. If you think about the column on the periodic table, if you just think electron configuration, it's fairly simple, where if you are adding an entire energy level every time you go down a period, so whenever you're going down the column, you're adding a full energy level. And every time you do that, you are making the radius get bigger and bigger and bigger because you're all the way down at 6s down here, right? You're all the way out to energy level 6, whereas way up here, you're only at energy level 1 or 2. So you can remember all of that, but what I like to do is kind of boil it down to a picture like this, where if I just know who is the smallest or who is the biggest, then that gives me all the trends I need. So you can either remember that helium and fluorine up here in this right-hand corner, they are really tiny. And then down here in the left-hand corner, francium is the very, very biggest. If I can just understand that, then I don't have to remember this whole left to right, up, down thing. I just know that as I move away from helium, what happens? I get bigger. Whether I'm going to the left or whether I'm going down, I'm getting bigger. So that's how we can understand the trend of atomic radius. It's really similar if we think about the size of ions. So what we were just talking about were neutral atoms and just comparing those. But if atoms have gained or lost electrons, it really makes a lot of sense. So with their size, if you are a cation, think about how do you become a cation? Cations are positive. To become positive, you have to lose electrons, right? So the way I kind of think about this is if you had a circle of people holding hands, let's just say that's similar to the electrons that are on the outermost level. If you have these electrons at the outermost level and you lose an electron, what can they now all do? When an electron is lost, all the electrons can move in a little bit closer. It's just like a circle of people holding hands. If someone leaves, the whole circle can get a little bit closer together because there's not as much repulsion going on there. So if I'm comparing calcium with his cation, calcium's going to be bigger. Okay? So parent atoms are bigger than their cations, or we can say cations are smaller than their parents. Anions, however, think about the opposite. Anions occur because you have added electrons. Well, if you have a circle of people and someone wants to get added, everybody has to back up and your circle is going to get bigger. So if you add electrons to make an anion, your atom just got bigger. So anions are always larger than their parent atoms. And then the last thing we see about ions, which is plain trends, is as you go down a column, so let's just choose the alkali metals group 1, lithium plus 1, sodium plus 1, K plus 1, rubidium, cesium. Just think about them simply again. As you move down a periodic table, you have added an energy level every single time. So cesium is going to be much bigger than lithium because even though you've lost an electron every time, you're still adding energy levels as you move down the periodic table. Same with anions. If you compare F minus 1, he has gained one electron. He now looks like neon. Chlorine minus 1 looks like argon. Bromine minus 1 looks like krypton. And iodine minus 1 looks like xenon. But once again, you are moving down the periodic table. So either way, you're going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. Then we want to be able to compare these ions that have the same number of electrons, or not even, ions or atoms that are isoelectronic. They have the same number of electrons. So, for example, first check with me here. Aluminum plus 3, let's all agree that he now has 10 electrons. He is isoelectronic to neon. And fluorine minus one, he had 9 and he gained 1, so he now has 10 electrons. Oxygen had 8 to start with, and now he has 10 because he's negative 2. Sodium had 11, he lost 1, and now he has 10. So first we have to be in agreement that all of these ions here have 10 electrons. I could have thrown neon in this group as well, because neon as a neutral atom has 10 electrons, right? So if all of the electrons are equal, then the way you would do the electron configuration would be exactly the same. They would all come out to be 2p6, and you kind of expect them to be the exact same size because they have the same arrangement of electrons. But what you compare is the magnet at the center of the atom, which is the protons, right? So think logically, if the protons are greater, that has the biggest charge and the biggest pull. So that's going to make this atom the smallest. Okay, so the more protons, the more shrinkage is going to happen. The more electrons are going to be pulled in. So aluminum plus 3 is going to be the smallest of these. And then next would be the sodium, because he still has a lot of protons also. He has 11 pulling on his electrons. And then next would be fluorine, because he has 9. And then the biggest atom here, or ion, would be oxygen minus 2, because he only has 8 protons. He has the weakest magnet in the center, so he's not pulling as hard on the electrons, so he's the biggest. So if your electrons are equal, you look at the number of protons, and the more protons, the smaller that atom will be. The next term we focus on is ionization energy. What ionization energy is the energy required to remove an electron from an atom. Okay, so it always takes energy to take an electron away, because the electron has to be at least somewhat attracted to the protons or he wouldn't stay around, right? So it's always going to require energy. First ionization energy is the energy required to remove the first electron from an atom. So you take a neutral atom and you take away one electron and you're left with a plus one. Okay, that's the equation that represents first ionization energy. Second ionization energy is when it's the energy required to remove the second electron. So you've already taken away one, which means you're starting as calcium plus one this time. You're taking away that second electron and you're landing as calcium plus two. The second ionization energy will always be more than the first, because once you've taken away one electron, all the electrons have scrunched in a little bit and there's greater nuclear charge on those electrons. So every time you're trying to take another electron away, that value is always going to go up. It's always going to require more. We do see another trend with ionization energy here, where once an atom becomes isoelectronic to a noble gas, you're going to see a huge jump in its ionization energy. So see if this makes sense. Sodium really likes to lose one electron, because if he loses one electron, he becomes like neon, which is very stable for him. That's why sodium always forms plus one. So it takes 490 fav joules of energy to remove one electron. But then if you try to take away a second, it takes 4,500 joules of energy. So do you see that incredible jump right there? We'll see it with magnesium as well, but we won't see it until magnesium plus two. Because look at magnesium on the periodic table. He's in group two. He likes to form a plus two charge because he likes to lose two electrons and become like neon. So no problem to lose one, that requires 738. He's still fine to lose a second one, 1,400. But then if you try to take a third, then it's gonna require 7,000 joules of energy. So you can see that at that time, you see this monumental leap in the ionization energy.